So we'll be starting this session on moving from 20th century teaching learning to 21st century teaching learning in a short while. But I'll since there were some technical issues before we departed during session 2, I'll just repeat the announcements that were made at the end of the session on peer review. First and major query from many participants that there has been a fluctuation in the peer review. Some peers are giving good grades and some are not giving good reviews. So what we are going to introduce is a mechanism of penalty points. So we are thinking of introducing a mechanism of penalty points. So all the participants who have queries with peer reviews, kindly consolidate your queries and send it to your mentor. And there is also a final segment where you can give feedback directly within the IIT Bombay system. So please provide the feedback on the review. So as soon as you read a review, below it there is a provision for feedback. So you can give the feedback over there, and additionally you can send the grievances to your mentor, who will be consolidating all these grievances and giving the final list to IIT Bombay. What we will be doing is, we are thinking of introducing some penalty points for improper review, because from the back end we will be able to identify who reviewed whom, and based on that we will get more information about it. So the second thing about how to enter text, what is the answer for the RCA 01, how to enter the answer in RCA 01 in FDP 201X, all you have to do is just type text in your entries. There is a box, so as Dr. Samir showed today morning, there is a box where you are supposed to write the answer. You can enter the answer over there. If you want to give student feedbacks, just summarize the student's reaction. It could be in the form of, let's say that students who did this particular thing, we administered a survey and we got so and so feedback, or like say some students who went on to do some more things. So it could be very quantitative outputs, like 67% of the students felt satisfied, things like that, or qualitative outputs like two or three students from this particular group went on to create Moodle server in their own systems and were experimenting with Moodle activities. So these could be qualitative things like these as well. Please ensure that you limit yourselves to 250 or 300 words, because if the answer is long, the reviewer will also have difficulties in assessing longer answers. To ensure that it is not just one review that is coming in, this time we have introduced that one single submission is being reviewed by more than one peer. So we have three peers who will be evaluating your response, and you will be getting reviews from each one of them. Now one more important thing about peer review. So the process of peer review, both from a teaching perspective as well as from a learning perspective. So if you are a reviewer, when you go through the rubric criteria, you will understand how to answer such open-ended questions. The criteria give you descriptions on how or what is the targeted performance, or what is in the current assignment, it is exemplary performance. So what is an exemplary performance? What is a poor performance? These have been detailed out as rubrics. Now with this, as a student, you will have an idea of what is expected at this point, and when you do the review, this will get reinforced. And this is why we are using peer assessment or peer review in both the FDPs, because the process of peers collaborating is something that we want at the end of this particular the FDP. There are a lot of teachers, there are a lot of practitioners out there, and it is important that each of you share, each of you collaborate to strengthen the process of teaching learning, which is becoming even more complex in the 21st century. I'll be now handing over the session to Professor Sahana Murthy, who is joining us from RC 1225. BMS College of Engineering, Bangalore. Over to BMS.
About moving from 20th century to 21st century. So we're just waiting for our center to get presenter control of the slides so that we can immediately get started in this FDC. And the way we will organize this session is we are starting around, it's about 2:10 or so. And it will be a very interactive presentation because it's finally, after all, it's a workshop. And you know that in a workshop, I think you all remember this. You all do work and I also have to do some work. So it's not just about hearing and talking. So we have a lot of activities which go along the theme of 21st century learning. So we'll just wait for a couple of minutes till we get presenter access. And as soon as we have that, we'll get started. Okay, looks like we're in shape now. So in the morning, you have heard a little bit about active learning and why it may be important. And you also have experienced some strategies over the course of the first FDP as well as this one. So let's actually get started with a warm-up activity. So for this entire session, for a long time, you will wear your hat as teachers and instructors who have a lot of experience. So in this first activity, it's not something that you need to share with anyone. It's just a short activity where you need some paper and pencil, or even you can just think about it. So firstly, think of one activity that you feel you excel at doing. Okay, write down your answer. No need to share with anybody. We'll do a lot of interaction later in the session. So write down some activity that you know you excel, you're an expert at doing. And I'd request participants, teachers, instructors at all the RCs, including the one here, to participate in all the activities. Okay, so once you know which activity or which skill you are an expert in, what you can do next is think about why you're so good at this skill or this activity. Write down the top three reasons for your mastery. So we look, and it doesn't have to be something related to your professional life. It could be, but it can be that you're very good at sports, or you may be good at a craft, you may be excellent at debate, it can be cooking, it can be anything from your everyday life that you're a master at. So write down three reasons for why you think you've developed mastery in this activity. Please make sure you have some writing implements near you. It could be a tablet, it could be paper and pencil, it doesn't matter. But each of you individually need to have some writing tool and writing instrument. Okay, so I'm going to do a little bit of magic now. I'm going to actually guess one of your top reasons. Okay, so let's see whether my magic actually works. So one of your top three reasons is likely to be practice or experience. Yeah? And something related to practice or experience. And if you think about it, this should not surprise us too much, because unless we practice, till we gain a lot of experience, how can we gain the mastery? Right? So I think this point is something we all would agree on. And now let's come back to our role as teacher, that as experts in a skill, we agree that we could not have gained mastery by simply listening. So now if you think of your students, do you think they can develop mastery just by listening to lectures? So in your role as experts at some sports or cooking, it's very unlikely that you'd heard some teacher speak about or give a talk about how to cook or how to win at badminton and still be such a good expert at it. So as teachers, the main point we want to make at this point is that we want to provide our students with similar practice that we did while gaining our mastery. So as teachers, let's give our students opportunities to practice sufficient and timely opportunities. So this entire session, as well as this entire FDP, is about how you provide such opportunities. And there was no interaction yet. This was just a warm-up hot activity. And the point we were trying to make is that if you are an expert, if you're a master at some skill, or if you're an expert at some activity, one of the top reasons how you became an expert is practice or experience. given that we all agree on this, our role as teachers is to make sure that we provide our students the same opportunity for practice, the same type of experiences that they should be able to develop as part of their learning. Okay? So the whole session, and in fact this entire FDP course, is about how do we provide such opportunities to our students. So I think that should summarize what we did so far. And we're going to come back to this point again, that as teachers, we need to ensure that we provide our students with sufficient and timely opportunities for practice. And there are multiple ways of doing so. So here is where as teachers our skill comes in. And there are multiple ways of doing so. Let's now look at two ways. So what we're going to do now is a debate. Okay. And the debate has two teachers. Let's call them teacher A and teacher B. So what the participants have to do, what the workshop coordinators have to do, that's something I'm going to say verbally, and it will also come in the slide. So don't worry if you don't know exactly what to do now. If nothing comes, then all you need to do is read the slides and hear what is being told. Okay, so there are two teachers. And both are good teachers. Okay, let's just take it as a given. But they have different teaching styles. So what teacher A does is that he gives an excellent lecture in the class. He demonstrates many problems, that is, he solves many problems on the blackboard, and he gives appropriate homework to the students as and when required. Okay, this is teacher A's approach. And what teacher B does is she does not lecture continuously, nor does she give as much homework together. Instead, she makes her students do a lot of activities in her class. She lets them practice what they have done. So if she gives a 10-minute presentation about some concept, if she explains a concept, immediately students practice in the class what they learned, and the teacher somehow ensures that they get feedback on their work right away. Okay, so these are your teacher A and teacher B. So now let's look at what you have to do with respect to the debate. So we'll spend a good 5 minutes on this. Within your RC, please form two groups, okay? You can either do left half on right half, or it doesn't matter. Basically, we need a lot of you as group A and a lot of you as group B. Just pick one of it. We don't want everybody to pick only one teacher. That's why the teachers on the left side can become teacher A, and teachers on the right side can think about teacher B. So group A, who's thinking about teacher A, write points for when teacher A's methods are more suitable. And group B, write points for when teacher B's methods are more suitable. So spend about 3 to 4 minutes individually. You can talk to your neighbors, because all group A's are sitting together, all B's are sitting together. Take 3 or 4 minutes and write down some points in favor of each teacher or each method. Once this is done, then I'll ask the RC workshop coordinator to do something else. So just hold off putting things on chat right now. But once we give a go ahead, then you can put it up on chat. Okay, one more minute for writing teacher A versus teacher B. Once the teachers in your RC have a few points, what the workshop coordinator can do is tell us via chat one point in favor of teacher A and one point in favor of teacher B. And then we'll collate them together. Okay, let's look at a few responses from the RCs. I'll just read out what things have come via chat, and perhaps hold off a few minutes. Many of you are making excellent points. Let me try to get a few of them. Okay, there are a lot of responses, which is really nice to see. So teacher A works when so many of you have written all these points. I'm going to summarize all your points together. So people who have written points in favor of teacher A say that if some foundational conceptual knowledge has to be given, or if an expert's approach has to be understood by students, teacher A's methods are more suitable. Similarly, in teacher A methods, students can ask questions, get clarification, but that can happen in teacher B also. What do students learn in teacher A? Looks like some of you are saying that students develop listening skills, and maybe as they listen, they also develop assimilation. Some others have said that teacher A's these methods work when there are very large students and when there is limited time. So these are some summary points with respect to teachers' ACE methods. Yeah, I think even in our RC here, that's what many of you have written. On the other hand, teacher B's methods work when we want students to do the task, when we want students to be in control of the activity, when we want students to explore. Some of you have written that teacher B's methods are actually more useful when we have complex tasks or multiple solution approaches, because if you have many students, different students can come up with different approaches to solve the problem. And in that case, a teacher B who does not do most of the problem solving herself, but she asks students to solve problem and articulate what they've done, teacher B's methods work better. Some of you have written that teacher B's methods actually help students develop potential and confidence because they are the ones who are actually doing the task. There are a few of you who've talked about peer learning in teacher B and team building and peer learning, because in teacher A, there is not much room for such, at least directly, it's not built into the instruction. Some of you have said engagement could be higher in teacher B. We'll come back to this issue of engagement. So we're not saying that we must do one or the other all the time, but if we ask ourselves which teacher do we typically follow, it turns out that most of us, for the majority of the part, somehow happen to follow teacher A. Am I right? Yeah. One reason why we follow teacher A so much is that we've been taught like teacher A. So many of us teach the way we learned in our childhood, in our college. We don't know how to be teacher B. I'm going to switch off the chat now, okay? We'll come back to the presentation and we'll do one more chat later. So if we want to summarize the debate, what we see is that we'll give some names now, okay? I'll give a bunch of jargon. So we're calling teacher A as the 20th century teacher. Some of you have written that this is a teacher-centric view. That phrase is also used. So why we call teacher A a 20th century teacher is that what happened in the 20th century, especially the middle and, you know, till, let's say, the 1990s, information was at a premium. Information was king. So the people, the experts who had information, who had expert information at their fingertips, were the experts. There was no internet. The books were more expensive. You may say, well, there was a whole library of information. But think about it. How often did we go to the library? How often do students go to the library? So access to information was very precious. So the ones who had it, they were the ones who were regarded as the experts. And they were valued a lot. And the experts who could transmit this information in an effective way also had a high value. So teacher A really made sense in this scenario, what we call as 20th century teacher. So what the students did at that point was mostly listen, and there were some note takers. They absorbed information during the lecture, and most of the practice was relegated to homework. This was the model, because the information is primarily with the teacher expert. So now if we ask what has changed in the 21st century, I think this is something which many of you or all of you would be aware of, because we are all now into the second decade of the 21st century. Information and access to information is no longer at a premium. There's lots of accessible information, lots of high quality, validated educational information in the form of videos, demos, animations, simulations, and so on. And it turns out that as teachers who mainly have the power of speech and at most a blackboard, we just cannot compete against this information that's there in the internet. In fact, we'd be foolish if we say that we'll do a better job at transmitting information than what these good videos and all is available. Okay? So it's not sufficient for a teacher to only transmit information effectively, which means the teacher's role has to change. It doesn't mean that teachers are obsolete. That's not at all the point we're making here. But the teacher's role has to change from the primary holder or giver of information to something else, something more effective in the new context, in this new environment where information is available. So what a teacher needs to do in this new environment is ensure that the students are able to assimilate and apply the information through appropriate practice during the class itself. So So one major change we are bringing in is in the timing of the practice. Teacher A gave a lot of practice during homework, after transmission of information, and teacher B is doing it during. So if you recall, a few slides ago, we said that there are multiple ways of doing practice. So here are two ways. And the way we want to frame this is we call it as the shift of focus from teacher-centric to learner-centric pedagogy. Sometimes it's also referred to as shift from content-centric to student-centric or learner-centric pedagogy. The pedagogy is the way we do teaching, the methods of teaching we use, and so on. So before we go into how we do it, let's just try to convince ourselves a little bit more. And let's ask ourselves that what evidence is there? You know, we have these two teachers and we all learned from teachers who are like A. So why isn't it enough to do teacher A? So the first reason is, of course, the environment has changed. The internet and information is a lot more available. But education researchers, like people from my department in IIT Bombay, we do a lot of research studies. We do experiments with teachers and with a lot of learners. And here I'm going to show you one evidence from what's called a meta-study. So a meta-study is actually an aggregation of multiple studies. So this particular result, which I'll show you in a minute, is actually from 62 courses, 62 teachers, not a single classroom. And this is from high school and first year college physics. The total number of students were over 6,000. And there were a variety of institutions. This particular result is from the United States, but then it has been replicated in many other parts of the world also. So this is from high schools, colleges, universities, and it's a semester-long physics course. And students were given a test before instruction. It's called a pretest. Then some teaching was done, either using teacher A's methods or B's methods. Okay, the teachers use one or the other. And then a similar test was given as a post-test. These are highly conceptual, reasoning-based tests. So you may ask, okay, what happened on these tests? And it turned out that this graph that you can see the bar. So I'll just walk you through this graph. You see these red bars on the left and green bars on the right. What's there on the horizontal, the x-axis, is what's called the fractional gain or the percentage gain. So this is how much students improved on the post-test compared to the pre-test. So they do a post minus pre and they normalize it and so on. It's called a normalized gain. And the numbers here are 0.1, 0.2, 0.2 is here, 0.25 is here, 0.3 is somewhere here. And the green bars, they go on up to about 0.7. So what you can see is that vertical axis, this is a histogram. The vertical axis is the number of courses. So it looks like the courses where red type of teaching was done seem to have percentage gains on this test from about 0.1 to maximum 0.3. But the green type of teaching courses had a higher gain. So now if you want to see who did teacher A and teacher B, it showed that what was seen is that all these reds are teacher A type of teaching and the greens here are teacher B type of teaching. Okay. So it turned out that people who were doing, let's go back to our A and B for a moment. The teachers who are using these methods, not lecturing continuously, instead making students do activities in class, scored a lot higher on an average. They were the greens. And the implication from this was that it's desirable for all of us, regardless of what teaching method we use, to explicitly incorporate these learner-centric teacher B type of activities in our teaching. Yeah, that's the main takeaway from these research studies. So if you're convinced by that, let's look a little bit into what we want to do exactly and how we want to do it. So far we have come up to the point that we want to move towards a learner-centric pedagogy because that is one way to give sufficient and timely opportunities. When the practice opportunity is needed, give it to students then and give immediate feedback. The main question facing us now is how do we do this? We all know it, we like it, but we have all these problems. We have to finish the portion. My principal shouts if there is noise in class. All these problems are there, right? So how do we do it if we are doing face-to-face course? How do we do it if we have to use technology? Let's say we have access to videos and animations in class. Can we go back to simply doing lectures? Is that sufficient to use videos? What if I have a large class? can I actually implement these learner-centric pedagogies? And at the same time, I need to be engaging, I need to engage all students, is that possible? So this entire FDP is really about how you can do it in various settings. And we look at some overview strategies in today's session itself. So one way, you may have heard this phrase, one way to actually engage students and to do learner-centric pedagogy is by what's called active learning techniques. So what happens in an active learning technique is there are three or four criteria. So let's just quickly go over these and then we'll do some examples. So the instructor creates carefully designed activities that require the student to talk, write, draw, reflect, speak, and express their thinking. Instructor creates these beforehand, these structured activities. Majority of the students in the class should go beyond listening and taking notes. Instead, what should they do? They should talk, write, reflect, talk to their neighbor, draw, debate in the class. And students are asked to figure things out, like students are asked to solve problems during the class. That's what mainly happens in active learning techniques. From a teacher's perspective, what we really need to do is shift our attitude firstly. So we have to move from a content-centric, content-oriented practice, teaching practice, to a learner-oriented. So we have to stop thinking primarily about which topic am I going to teach, can I complete it, and instead we also have to let go of the question, how well am I lecturing? Instead, we have to focus on the question, how well are students learning? Are they learning what we want them to learn? So it begins with the shift of attitude, and then there are some strategies to help us. Okay. So before we go into actual strategies, let's actually do one more activity, and this is a poll. So we're going to do this in two phases. In the first phase, I'm going to ask all the participants to actually individually write down your answers, or you can actually vote with your fingers, okay, in your class. In the second phase, I'll ask the RC, the workshop coordinator, to upload their answer on the poll. So let me actually first make you read everything, and then I'll activate the poll. Okay, so there is some teacher, let's call this teacher C. She lectures you. And every 20 minutes or so, she pauses and asks, do you have any doubts? And often 3 to 5 students do raise their hand and there is a small discussion happening at that point, and then the teacher resumes the lecture. Okay, this is teacher C's method. My question is here at the on the title, is this teacher doing active learning? Is this teacher practicing an active learning strategy by doing all this? Yes or no? So what you can do at this point is briefly in your RC, just vote for yes or no. And why don't you do one thing? I'll get you started on the next stage. Write in your notebook, this will require 30 seconds, what your individual opinion is. Each one of you write. Once you've done that, turn to your neighbor. Find a neighbor who has a different answer than you. Okay, and start discussing. Try to converge on an answer, and I'll set up the poll in the meantime. Workshop coordinators expect and encourage a lot of noise and a lot of discussion at this point. Okay? Try to find somebody who has a different answer. You can get up, move. Do you think this teacher is doing active learning? Okay, so I think in your RCs by now you have done your voting and all. You've also discussed with your neighbor. So I'm going to start the polling. Workshop coordinator can look at the majority answer, whether this teacher is doing active learning, and convey it via the poll. So I'm going to start the polling just now. The polling has started. So I'm going to start viewing some results now. Okay, looks like at least 60 RCs have responded, and I'm going to hold off on saying what the results are. A few more are coming in. I think we have over around 200 RCs or so. So let's wait for a few more minutes. Okay, last 15 seconds, please submit your the majority answer from your RC if you have not yet done. Okay, I think most of you have submitted an answer. We have about 146 votes, which means 146 centers have responded, and the number of yeses are 43 and the number of noes are 103. So it looks like larger number of you think it's not, but still a fair number of you think that what this teacher is doing is active learning. So let's try to deconstruct this question, and let's go back to the slides. I'm going to go back to desktop sharing. Okay, so here we are back to the slides, and you've done a poll. We've gone to this stage, and I just want you to check with yourself. I don't need an answer here. Did any of you change your answer between the discussion? Nobody changed your answer? Think. So maybe during the discussion, some of you may have. Let's come back. So this teacher is actually not doing active learning. Why is that so? Let's look back at the definition of active learning. Okay. The two main points we said was that the instructor creates carefully designed activities that require students to talk, write, reflect, and express their thinking. What this instructor did was she tried to interact with the students, but she did it in a very unstructured, informal way. She just stopped her lecture and asked students, do you have questions? That's not what's meant by carefully designed activity. And the key word here is require students to talk. Secondly, majority of the students were only listening. In this scenario, only three students raised their hands, three or five. And this is a very typical scenario. If you ask in your class, do you have any doubts? In a class of 50, you may get three, five. If you get 10, that's quite a lot. Okay, so two major criteria of active learning are not fulfilled by this teacher C, who lectures and simply interrupts, asks if you have doubts. So you may ask, okay, what's the big problem? You know, it has interaction. I am doing interaction. I pause and ask students if they've understood. I allow students to interrupt. I don't hesitate to answer their questions. I even show demos. What's wrong with this whole thing? And the point we are trying to make here is that such interactive lectures are not sufficient. We are not saying don't do it, but they're not enough. They're not sufficient. And there are several reasons for this. One is that if you have a 60 or a 90 minute lecture, students may not pay utmost attention to the entire lecture. You may see bursts of attention and bursts of engagement, usually in the early side of it. More dangerous is that students think they understood because you are an excellent lecturer. They think they're following what you're doing, but they're actually not understanding it. And they don't have an opportunity where they get confronted with their misconceptions. This is something a teacher often doesn't know, because if you think about it, when do you come to know what misconceptions teachers have, the students have? The test, which happens a week or sometimes even a few months later. So students don't get this opportunity to see what they haven't understood. So this is a big problem. It's also difficult to ensure that everyone in class or a majority of the class participates evenly and actively. It's often the ones with high motivation, high interest, the ones who sit in the front three benches who raise their hands. Students with low motivation or who are shy, they get left behind. And a lot of students are daunted. They have a barrier to answering a question directly to posed by the instructor. Okay, students may not want to actually speak up in class. And if you try to force students, it's often counterproductive. So because of all these problems, interactive lectures like what that teacher C was doing in the poll is not a very good idea. So what should we do in active learning? We have talked about these, the first two points. There are two more points that these structured activities are actually, they come from psychology learning theories. People have derived them, and then they have been empirically tested several times, like the result, the evidence that we saw a few slides ago. Okay, so let's look at a few examples here. Examples of such strategies. So one strategy is called peer instruction. And it's very similar to what you did when you did the poll. It has some voting, but it's a little more than that. So the teacher poses a question. Okay, this is the anatomy of peer instruction. It's a very structured activity. And the teacher can give one round of individual voting. Then the teacher actively opens it up for discussion among the participants. So this is where I said, talk to your neighbor, convince each other, converge on an answer. And most of the time what happens is that in this phase, the one on the right side, the peer discussion phase, That's where a lot of learning happens. That's where reasoning happens. And then what we did not do today is that students are asked to vote a second time. And then there is a debriefing or a class discussion. So the debriefing is like this slide. This is the debriefing. Yeah. So this technique is called peer instruction. And it's been used in a lot of different topics, starting from mathematics, physics, chemistry, to engineering, computer science. If you are teaching humanities or management, it's used a lot there. And there's a lot of research evidence for this technique. Okay. So what we will do in the rest of the FDP later this week or next week is have you construct and create peer instruction questions for your own class. So that will be one major activity that you'll do, and we'll walk you through more process steps as to how you do it. But right now, let's just look at a few peer instruction questions, some examples from science and engineering domains. Okay, the one we saw with the poll earlier, this is from education domain. So as teachers, you are all familiar with it. But now imagine that you're in your own science or engineering class. What kind of peer instruction questions can you write then? So I'm not going to ask you to vote. Okay, please don't vote here. I'm not. And if you don't understand the domain, just wait for the next slide. So this is something from introductory programming where you can give a small snippet of a program, small piece of a program, and ask a question. What will happen if we change the function call from something to something else? So what will happen if is a very nice stem for a peer instruction question. Have students vote. And then let them discuss and converge on an answer, and then move on to the discussion, the debriefing phase. So you can change any important key piece of the program and ask what will happen to the output. Okay, that this is one example. So we'll just look at three or four examples of this nature. This one is from circuits, high school or early first level electrical engineering course. So there are three bulbs in the circuit. There's one and two, and bulb three is attached to a switch which is initially open. Okay, so initially there are two bulbs, and then the switch is closed and the third bulb is included in the circuit. Pose a question to the students, what will happen to the brightness of bulb one after bulb three is connected? If you want, just think about it quickly in your room. There is a very obvious answer here, but the obvious answer need not be the right answer. So when we bring in more bulbs, it's the same battery, we're not changing the battery. Many of you may think that, well, more bulbs are coming into the picture, so maybe the brightness will go down. But then if you work through it, you'll see that the answer is very counterintuitive. So a question like this is excellent as a peer instruction question, because after you do it and do two rounds of voting and students discuss, some students actually get the idea that, look, these two are in parallel, they talk of resistances, equivalent resistance and so on. So some students actually do think in terms of those conceptual reasoning techniques. So when you open up the entire class for discussion, you will see that students are able to converge on the answer, and then you can actually show an animation or an experiment video to show what really happens in this. Here's an example from any mathematical or the early part of any topic. This is about vectors, and this is mainly about connecting concepts and diagrams. It's a very good idea to ask peer instruction questions where students are asked to reason between a diagram, an equation, and some concepts. So here it asks, what's the relationship between the three vectors? Are they additive, subtractive? If so, in what direction, and so on. So if you note, none of these are numerical answer questions. They're very conceptual. They require reasoning. They require diagrams. Here is one more, the last one, I think. Here is, this is back from circuits. This is some transfer voltage in, voltage out characteristics. And the students are asked to reason which circuit below produces this output. So often you will see the stem of your question can either be what will happen if I change something, or if this is the output, what will be the input? You can also ask questions like, if this is the input, what will be the output? But make students think in terms of diagrams and connect it to equations. Don't stick only to numerical questions. So here, these were three or four examples, and this was just an overview. You'll do a whole week in this FDP about such a technique. So now let's look a little bit about the implementation, actual classroom implementation. How many of you have watched or at least heard about Kaun Banega Crorepati? Yeah, I don't even need to ask this. So you remember the clickers used there? So in many classrooms, we use these clickers to have students vote on their choice. Okay, so if you have access to clickers, this is one way to implement peer instruction. Clickers by itself is not peer instruction. What's really peer instruction are those two rounds of voting and discussion on a conceptual question. But the implementation can be via clickers. If you say, well, you know, I don't have clickers in my class, I know, and my principal refuses to spend that much money, can I do something? Well, you can use flashcards. So a flashcard, I'll just do a quick demo. It's very easy to do it. Take a piece of paper, white paper like this. If you have sketch pens or markers, use them. I'm just using a ballpoint pen, so it's not clear, but divide it into four pieces, okay? A, B, C, D, yeah, four pieces. And then if you use any black sketch pen or red or pink or something, you can have students fold it like this and hold up their answer. So what's being shown here are those flashcards. You don't have to buy anything. You can just take a very simple piece of white paper and some thick markers are, that's all you need. Every student can create one of these set of flashcards in a class. You don't even want to do that. If you say, well, you know, that's too much work, you can use fingers. Okay. The only thing with fingers is don't ask students to raise their hands like this. Okay. This is not advisable. Instead, I'll try to demo this. Ask students to hold up their answers in front of their chest. Can you see my fingers near my neck? Okay. Any idea why we ask people to hold up here and not? I think you can see my three fingers now. Now it's only one finger. Yeah? Why do we recommend this and not this? So in the first round, we want people to think individually. We don't want, it's not about copying. We do allow them a lot of chance to talk to each other. We want them to talk and copy, but we don't want them to get influenced by somebody else initially. And we want every student to make a committed choice. So why this works so well is because initially, if you remember, I said take out your notebooks and write. That starting 30 seconds is important. Once everybody has an answer down, open the floor for as much talking and copying. In fact, copying is good in that case. It's not exactly mindless copying. It's convincing the neighbor of their answer. There are some others, so I'll show you some other high-tech ones. So this is from here, there is some optical recognition. I'm not sure if this is very clear. I'll upload these slides on Moodle. There's actually a scanner in the front of the classroom and it can optically scan these cards, the colors that the students have. If you say, well, I want to I'm doing some online course. Can I do peer instruction? Yes, there are many things you can do either in synchronous or in asynchronous mode. So in asynchronous mode, Moodle has quizzes and polls, and tomorrow we'll talk a lot about it. In synchronous mode, there are many real-time voting tools. Much of this is free. So the one here is called Mentimeter. As a teacher, you can open an account, set up a peer instruction question, and your students can use their mobile phones to do it. It's actually a good idea to use mobile phones for such things. Don't be afraid of technology and don't be afraid that students will do this and that. Make sure you have an engaging question and everybody will be on task. Many other, if you don't want it, AVU poll is there if you're doing blended and online type of teaching. If you don't like cell phones, don't worry, go back to flashcards. But this is the range of tools available and see if you can exploit them. Okay, so let's look at one more quick strategy. And then we will do an open Q&A. Okay, another 10 minutes or so, we'll look at one more strategy. And then we can do an open floor transfer with many of the centers. So consider a class. So now you're back in your classroom as teachers. And consider a large class, 100 or 300 or 50, whatever you consider as a large class. And imagine you have a 90-minute class with a large auditorium. Okay. How engaged are your students throughout the 90 minutes? High, medium, low, okay? So what I want you to do individually, you'll need a paper and pencil. If you have a laptop, I want you to draw something. So individually, just take a minute and draw a graph of percentage of engaged students versus time. as the 90 minutes in your class go on. So horizontal axis is time in your class. Vertical axis is percentage of students who are engaged at every point in your class. Quickly draw a graph. Okay, do this individually. And actually 30 seconds are enough for this. I think most of you have a graph that looks like this. Maybe some of you have a little spikes in between. Maybe you told a joke or something at this point. Or maybe, you know, some interruption happened. Okay, so this is how our typical classes are. Question for you, now I want you to turn to your neighbor in your RCs. Suppose you wanted to convert that graph that went like this, to something that stayed more or less stable at 80% engagement. This is point 8. Come up with one technique with your neighbor, how you can convert that graph to something like this. One technique for the topic you teach. Okay, this will require a little more time. So take 3 or 4 minutes, and I'm going to give you a hint here in case you've forgotten the last half an hour. Think in terms of learner-centric or active learning techniques. Take 2 minutes, talk to your neighbor, come up with some strategy, okay, to make that downward-facing graph into a flat graph, and then we'll see where to go from here. Okay, I'm going to move ahead and then come back to this slide. What the workshop coordinator can do is identify one technique from your RC that's a learner-centric technique, but don't say something very generic. Don't say something that I want to engage students in discussion. What kind of discussion? What question will you ask? Try to get a little more specific, because you can't engage them in a discussion for 90 minutes. And I'm going to put up one slide after this for you, for each one of you, as a self-check. If you have come up with a technique, ask yourself, is it truly learner-centric? If you say something like, I will do, I will show, I will tell, you're still operating in teacher-centric mode. On the other hand, if you say, I will make students do, you're moving towards learner-centric. Better still, if you say students will do something, you are bang in the learner-centric active learning strategy. Okay? So when I see an interesting technique, I will say that out. Some of you have said that peer instruction technique can be used, and you're absolutely right. The technique we just saw, peer instruction, is a very powerful technique to keep your engagement graph stable at 80%. Somebody has said engage students in chain notes technique. I'm not exactly sure what it is, but I think it's a structured technique. Do group problem solving in class. That's again valuable. Think, pair, share. The way we've been doing just now, the way you did in the morning. That's one valuable technique. Role play, some of you have said. So again, all of these are useful techniques. Let's move on now. Again, you have the entire month to think about these. But the main point is, if you want to go to a learner-centric technique, you have to be able to say students will do X and the teacher will facilitate it by doing Y. Okay, that's what your learner-centered techniques start with. Okay, so a few more examples here. The one we just saw now, that's called Think, Pair, Share, where you first individually wrote something, then you talked to your neighbors, and then the coordinator did a class-wide sharing. In our case here, the class comprises of about 200 centers and maybe even several thousand participants. Okay, so there's a class-wide sharing. Okay, so summary, if you want to engage students in active learning techniques, make them do problem solving during the lecture, make them work collaboratively, ask them to figure out things on your own. Ask them to express their reasoning. For example, why did you choose choice B? Why do you think A is wrong? Questions like that are very meaningful. And students should get rapid feedback on their work. Immediately, students should be able to, and it need not be individual feedback. It can be group feedback by saying choice B doesn't work in this case because of these reasons. Okay, there are some other 2 examples we saw just now, peer instruction and think, pair, share, and there are many other examples, team, pair, solo, problem-based learning,
just in time teaching, role play, jigsaw, case based learning, peer review. We will do a few of these this month in this FDP. If you're in labs, there are many active learning techniques you can use in labs. So in computer science programming labs, you can do something called pair programming or pair problem solving. In tutorials or problem solving sessions, you can do problem-based learning, database problem solving. There are many structured techniques. Okay, so details will come during the rest of the FTP, including a lot of references for where you can find the procedures for such techniques. Okay. What if you're using technology like videos and animations? How can you do active learning with those? That is exactly tomorrow morning session, integrating videos and simulation in teaching and learning. Yep. What if you want to use Moodle? Because I think in FDP 1, you worked a lot with Moodle. So can you do active learning in Moodle? That is tomorrow afternoon or late tomorrow morning session, utilizing Moodle for higher order learning outcomes. And of course, the rest of the FDP also will be doing some of these. Okay. So last poll, will you implement active learning in your class? I'm actually going to put this poll and let the RC workshop coordinator just give the majority view. I'll put back the question. Will you implement? Wait. Please wait. Yeah. I have four choices. It's not a simple yes or a no. I'm just going to put up the choices. Okay, so let's start polling here. There are four choices. Yes, I will definitely implement them more than once a week. No, unless I have more info, I won't implement them. C is I will try. D is I want to implement them, but I have some concerns. Okay, I actually want you to think carefully about A, B, C, D, and then we'll see. Okay, looks like many of you are saying you will do more than once a week. Some say you will try about once a week. Some say you have concerns. Actually, you're quite right to have concerns, and there are some typical concerns. The two major concerns that come up is completion of syllabus, and the second one is the noise level. Okay, these are the two things. The noise level is a little easier to discuss. So let me just briefly talk about each of these, and then we can take more of it during the Q&A session. Noise by itself is not bad. This kind of noise that happens during the peer discussion is very productive noise. Okay, so that's, you have to be convinced that actually good noise is happening. If you find students talking off topic or thinking about discussing the party that happened yesterday and all, then you can do things to change that. But typically once students get engaged, and the way they get engaged is if the question is at the right level of challenge. It can't be too easy, then they'll get bored. Simple numerical questions are not suitable. It can't be so difficult that they get daunted. So this right level of challenge is something you have to gauge as a teacher. But once the question is at a right level of challenge, students do get engaged. If you're having trouble from your management about noise, I would suggest you talk to other teachers in your colleagues who think this is a good idea. Tell them that the educational technology department in IITB recommends this. Show them research articles. So there are a lot of things you can do. Okay. I'll come to syllabus completion in Q&A. I'm sure somebody is going to ask that anyway. So the main takeaway from this overview session on active learning and moving from teacher-centric to student-centric is that we want to make students grapple with content during our classes, during the lecture, during the teaching, okay, not only at home. Don't merely clarify doubts in class. Do something more than that. Use established and proven methods like active learning strategies. We saw a whole list of them. Provide frequent opportunities for learners to work with the content and ensure immediate and frequent feedback. Okay, so if you do some of these, then in terms of learning gains, in terms of engagement, you'll see high results, both engagement and learning. It's not just one or the other. Okay, you'll see that your engagement graph, instead of going downwards like this, is more like that. Okay, so I think we have time, about 20 minutes or so, for questions. There are a lot of resources that we've created in our educational technology program at IIT Bombay. You can go to our website and go to resources and teaching strategies. We have videos of workshops, slides. We have something called activity constructors that you'll be doing in the FDP. And what the activity constructor does help you, the way it helps you is it scaffolds you to create a question for your own class, for your own topic. So it asks you a series of questions. It's more like a worksheet. And after you finish writing the answers to the questions, you can create a question, one of the active learning techniques for your own class. Okay, so let's stop the presentation. And I think we are going to use the question format, right? VP Samaj, KBT College of Engineering, Nashik. Over to you.
My question is, how do we ensure that each student watch the video before coming to the flipped classroom?
Okay, so the question is, if we are doing flipped classroom, how do we ensure that students have watched the video? We will do a couple of sessions on flipped classroom, but there are some techniques which I'll just quickly mention them. Often teachers do a brief 10-minute quiz at the beginning of the in-class part of the flipped classroom. And that beginning part is based exclusively on the video. And it turns out that students who have watched the video can answer the questions, and the ones who haven't, they find it difficult. So this is a sort of a carrot/stick incentive for students to watch the video. Secondly, for the in-class part, if you make sure that the activities can be done only if students have watched the video, that's another incentive for students, that if they come to class without having watched it, they're really lost in class. So that's another thing teachers use. What is not a good idea is if you repeat contents from the video, because then students feel that, well, it doesn't matter whether I see it or not. Yeah, so these are some quick techniques, and we have a session, we'll do one more detailed session perhaps in the asynchronous phase in the FDP. Okay, let's look at Center 1059, Garda Institute of Technology, Ratnagiri.
My question is, ma'am, how we can manage the time? Because using a flipped classroom, it's much more time consuming, like to prepare a video, to edit a video. The flipped classroom concept is completely time consuming.
Okay, thank you for the question. The question was, how do we manage time if we are doing a flipped classroom? See, I'm not sure how much in detail you've gone through the flipped classroom. Perhaps in the FDP one, you went through, not yet. Okay, so we will talk a lot about flipped classroom in FDP 2. Flipped classroom has two parts, out of class part where students already watch a video or read a book or go through resources. And then in class, what happens is exactly what we discussed today. So the out of class part is watch a video, answer some short questions. In class is active learning. And as a teacher, when you have to think about proportioning your own time, for the out-of-class part, you don't need to create your own videos each time. There are plenty of existing good resources, videos, animations, simulations that many other people have used. So you can always use those and minimize your time. If you want to create your own videos, you're absolutely right. It does take a lot of time. You have to use your out-of-class time, or you have to try to get extra time somehow. In class active learning, what you can do with respect to time management here, and this goes back to how do we complete the whole syllabus. Here, you have to be wise in choosing which topics you will do for the active learning and which topics you will not do. It's not possible to do a 15-minute think pair share in every class and still lecture. Okay. So what you'll have to think about is that the topics where you decide to do a think pair share of, you need not do an elaborate lecture beforehand. Or if you do two examples using peer instruction, the third example can be given as homework. Usually when students learn using peer instruction or think pair share or any active learning technique, they learn how to learn, which means they don't need to be told every variation. They are now at a stage where they can learn on their own. Okay, so that's one way you can proportion your time. Let's go to Center 1240 because Professor Kannan from IIT Bombay wants to join. Yeah, over to you, 1240.
My query is, students are basically judged on the terms of the end semester examinations they have. So how can we motivate these students to get involved in the class and motivate flipped classrooms more and more, because they're not eventually being evaluated on such things?
Okay. So this question is about motivation of students, and especially since all of them have to pass the exams. And this is a realistic point. It's not something we can ignore. We can't say let's only do active learning all the time. And see, all these are, as a teacher, we have to really think in terms of a designer, which means there are some pros and cons and trade-offs, a lot of trade-offs you'll have to make. If you think only in terms of exams, the thing that you're letting go, the trade-off is of learning. If you think only in terms of engagement and active learning, the trade-off is about completion of syllabus and maybe exams. So I'm going to ask a question back to you. Is there some part of the exam that you can be responsible for? That doesn't come from a university which somebody else has set. Maybe it's 20% of the syllabus. Maybe it's in the lab. So first, identify portions where you can be in charge of the exam, and then make sure that the exam questions are very similar to the kind of active learning, to the questions they do in the active learning strategies. And students are absolutely right when they have to focus more on the exams and not on what you do in class. So let's use it to our advantage. Let's try to change the exam so that we ask questions of the type, what will happen if, or connect the diagram to the equation and so on. So this is one, this is sort of the first answer I can give you. For the rest of it, again, you'll have to think about, can I insert a 5-minute peer instruction somewhere? Because students are, they do want to be engaged. And if you say I'm going to use 5 minutes in a 1-hour class twice a week, you're not going to suffer too much in terms of syllabus coverage. So try to be clever in terms of using your time. Do the small structured in-class activities. You use Moodle to do something else. Okay, so here are some answers.
Hi, Sahana. This is Kannan here.
Yeah, hello, Professor Kannan.
I just wanted to say hello to you all. Raipur, I happen to be here, so I just wanted to see how people are doing. It's an exciting environment, very active. They're all very sharp and they were asking right questions. So I wish the course every success.
Okay, thank Bye. You very much, Kannan, and great to have you with us, Center 1240. Let's go to Center 1193.
Yeah, in this active learning process, the student needs to devote more time. Mm-hmm. And there is a lot of hesitation. Yeah, so...
Okay, so let's look at this concern. It's actually a important concern. So the question is, students often need to devote more time and more effort. And you're absolutely right, because we are asking them now to no longer simply sit and hide. Students can't hide when the teacher is doing active learning. They have to participate. And there may be some hesitation among the students. So I'm not sure what your personal experience is when you try some of these structured techniques. In the beginning, there will be some hesitation because this is something very new for students. It's important for us as teachers to tell them why we are doing this, what are the benefits. There was one slide that I skipped over earlier. We'll pick it up tomorrow on what are the benefits to students by doing all these. So students also need to have buy-in into these techniques. And as a teacher, how you can increase this buy-in is starting by talking to them why we are doing this, show them results about increased engagement and increased learning. And also, one thing that makes or breaks the success of these techniques is the type of questions you put in your active learning strategies. If it's boring, if it's something that they know you'll do anyway next week in lecture, then they won't be engaged. But if it's something that engages them at an intellectual level, then my experience, I've been doing this for almost 20 years, such techniques at all levels, starting from younger children are more likely to be engaged, but also with a lot of college students at various institutes and universities. Students usually jump in. Typically, it takes 3 to 4 sessions for them to warm up to you. If you hear only silence, don't get bothered by it. What I do is, if I hear pin drop silence after posing a PI question, I say, look, I'm not going to continue until one person says something. So the next 30 seconds, there is a lot of discomfort and people are shifting. And then somebody says something and the ice breaks, somebody laughs, and from then everybody joins in. So it takes about 3 sessions for the class as a group to warm up to you. So don't be afraid of silence in the beginning. If they see that this is routine in your class, you do it every time regardless, then it just becomes very regular. We've done think, pair, share and peer instruction in a class of 250 for an entire semester. Every 90 minute class had about 45 minutes devoted to these techniques. And there was a little bit of hesitation in the beginning, but just the first week. Okay, let's look at Center Mahalingam College of Engineering, Coimbatore.
Hello.
Over to you.
In active based learning, you told a lot of research papers are available. Can you please expand about a little bit about that?
Okay, thanks for the question. So the question is, I had mentioned earlier that there are a lot of research papers available about active learning. And can we share those? Can we expand? So the kind of experiments people do are, these are called controlled experiments. And usually there is somebody trained in education research methods who is overseeing it. There's also a domain instructor who's the main teacher, somebody from an engineering or science background. And once an active learning strategy is designed and polished by them, they decide to teach using this strategy maybe for one section. So suppose the teacher is teaching 2 sections, A and B. Section A is taught a topic using the active learning strategy and section B is taught using a traditional topic. And then maybe a different topic is taken and it's switched. A gets the traditional teaching and B gets the active learning way of learning. And then the results are compared. So these are called controlled studies. And the type of results people look for are, so it's important what you measure also. Your regular traditional exams are unlikely to give you any difference in results. Instead, you have to have very carefully written conceptual questions, reasoning type of questions, and there you're likely to see more differences. People also measure engagement. People also, student engagement, there are ways to do it. They measure students' perceptions. So what the student thought about one method versus another method, how likely is the student or how much does the student want to learn using this method and so on. So what we can do on Moodle is I'm going to request Jaikrishnan to upload on Moodle some of these papers about learning and engagement using active learning. So as the FTP continues, you'll be able to read these papers. So let's take Center 1103 Shirpur, NMIMS Shirpur.
Ma'am, actually there are 2 questions. First question is that I recently took a flipped classroom in my active class, and in that 60% of the students watched the video and they came prepared for the active class, while 40% couldn't see it for one or the other reason. And then I was not being able to understand how to manage those 40% in the class, while 60% were actively doing the problem solving.
So about flipped classroom and video watching, I had mentioned earlier, try giving a short quiz based on the video in the first 5 minutes. Just a 5 minute short quiz. Your 60% might go up a little bit. Yeah. What's your second question?
The second question is, there are few participants over here who are interested in publishing such work out of their experience. So we would like to know good journals where they can publish their work.
Okay, the second is about doing research in these techniques. So it's not something you can do right away, but we do want to get more and more people involved. So we have a few programs. And again, I think we can share with you a list of journals, but it's not as straightforward as knowing which journal and doing some study. There are techniques, very specific techniques, research techniques, just like different research techniques in different engineering and science departments, education also has its own techniques. So those are some things that the researcher has to learn quite well. And we have some resources for those. We'll try to share those and the programs that we have with respect to doing research in your own class.
Okay, thank you so much, again, ma'am. We'll look forward for that.
Yeah, I'll make sure that we put it up on Moodle over the next few days.
Okay.
So the last question is from BMS Bangalore, since I'm here, in case anybody has a question.
So how are the tools which are coming out we use for effective like teaching learning process? So I'm basically a biochemist. Mm-hmm. I teach biochemistry, and that will draw a lot of structures and all. So the way I draw the diagrams on the board and even the mechanisms I explain while writing. So whatever the tools I use, it's not going to be that much effective. Even I do use tools actually, it's not that I didn't. But still, while drawing the structures and all, whatever the structures I show it using videos, even animations. So generally, like now when I draw it, and students easily they will follow it. Okay, so what are your comments?
Okay, so there is an observation and then a question. Yeah, so this can be from any domain, even though the question was from biochemistry, that there is a difference between showing a video of some complex diagram and actually drawing it step by step on the board. Yeah. There's a difference in the learning. So I do agree with you. There is clearly a difference. So let me make one thing clear. What we are not recommending is to simply play a video which has the canned final answer. Okay. There is a lot of technology which does help the teacher and the student construct such diagrams step by step that exists. There are also some videos which do it step by step. So I'm going to leave this as a teaser. And this is a teaser for my colleague who is going to do tomorrow morning session. What he's going to discuss tomorrow is how do you teach effectively with such videos? Suppose your video doesn't do a step-by-step drawing. Can you augment, as a teacher, can you do something and still teach with it effectively? Because one thing we know is that suppose you have a 3D molecule. The video will do a much better job than what you draw on the board. Yeah. So, but on the other hand, the video may be very passive, and when you do it, it may be more engaging. So how do you combine the best of the two? Okay, such things, there are some techniques you can use with the video. So, okay, to give you a very sneak preview of the answer, videos and animations are not to be played from end to end. That's not the way you use them. You pause it at a point where the suspense is the highest. Do an active learning question at that point. So do a peer instruction question saying, what is the next shape in the molecule? Or what will happen if I do a mirror image? Make students vote. Make students do a TPS. It can be 1 minute, it can be 15 minutes. And then show the answer in the rest of the video. So this has been found to be very useful. You break up a video, and then when you want to use your hand drawing, sure, do that also. So you use a judicious combination. Yeah, so a combination of, the technology tools by themselves don't have any intelligence. It's you as the teacher who's bringing in the intelligence and the engagement. But so you have to use them not just judiciously, you have to use them to your benefit. Simply playing a video is not very useful. Okay. So I think let's close this session. Thank you all very much and hope you have a very productive rest of the FTP. Thanks.